platform and share our experiences piloting it in our online courses. My name is April Samaras, and with me today are Ling Thompson and Erin Harkness, instructional designer and instructional technologist, and Janeen Galligan and Marnie Pickens, who, like myself, are faculty members, and we are here with you from Regis University in Denver, Colorado. Sorry about that. So who are we? Regis is a liberal arts Jesuit Catholic university serving both traditional and post-traditional students through transformative education rooted in faith, reason, and culture. And for this pilot, we are testing Yellowdig in our post-traditional classes in the School for Professional Advancement. Which specifically serves the post-traditional learners in our college. Demographically, our students are working professionals, parents and spouses seeking their bachelor's or master's degrees that are navigating the balance between work, school, and family. Our classes are typically in 7 and 8 week accelerated formats, and usually they range in size from 5 to 25 students. In a typical online class, the first student to post will probably come up with something interesting, and usually up to 5 or 6 students can post something new or something that others will find useful to read that has a new perspective. But then what? In our experience, responses often become deja vu, and it gets harder and harder for every student to come up with something they're excited to share. Often they'll find an answer in the forum that sort of reflects what they want to say, and then it becomes an exercise in semantics, how to say the same thing using different words so you're not really copying other people's ideas. Although the instruction often says discuss, this isn't really a good way to start a real discussion. The question leads to a collection of individual answers. As faculty, we may throw in some probing to deepen the thinking, but regardless of the good intentions, this doesn't usually lead to a deeper discussion, let alone true collaboration and more meaningful learning. So in essence, unless your discussion is about a truly controversial issue with opposing views, it's hard for something exciting to constantly be going on in the discussion board. And people won't participate in the same ways and with the level of meaningful interaction that we all want. Like many online programs, we're finding the post once, reply twice approach to online discussion often uninspiring. And since participation is such a vital component of the grade in an online key and of such incredible importance in building an online community, quite often students and we as instructors fall into mundane response patterns. So when our instructional design team suggested we pilot Yellowdig, we were super excited to investigate. So today in our time together, we'll discuss how Yellowdig impacts student participation and engagement. We'll discuss how Yellowdig could be used at your institution and to determine if Yellowdig is a tool that your institution would like to further investigate. Something to note, because we're doing a pilot, we don't yet have Yellowdig integrated into our system. So we're speaking from limited experience and functionality. So we're happy to answer any questions about that later on, but just keep that in mind as we begin our discussion. So we'll now turn it over to Ling, our instructional designer.
Thanks, April. I'm going to take us to dig a little deeper and talk about, so what is Yellowdig and what does it look like? So Yellowdig is a gamified discussion platform. It looks a lot like a social media site. It's very intuitive to navigate the site and post text, images, and videos. Emojis and the reaction buttons are all built into the system. Now, traditional discussion board follows a formula we're all too familiar with, right? Students need to respond to the same question by Wednesday and reply to at least 2 other students by Sunday. Yellowdig doesn't have these restrictions. So the best practice is for instructors to give students guidance and or ideas of what to post each week. We still need to give students somewhat of boundary so they don't wander too far off the topics and end up sharing recipes for the whole course, let's see. Students are motivated to post the resources that they resonate with the most or their own reflections on the learning topics. And the system does automatic points calculation for each user. There are many ways for students to earn points. They can earn points by creating initial postings, by commenting on others' postings, by receiving likes and accolades, and also by people commenting on their initial posts. They get rewarded if their initial post gains traction in the community. So pretty much the more active you are, the more points you receive. Throughout the course, students have to earn enough Yellowdig points to get a full participation grade of the course. So with that being said, I'm going to hand it over to Erin next. She's our instructional technologist.
Thank you, Ling, for that intro. So you might be wondering, how exactly do you start creating your Yellowdig community? So the first step is to create your community, which is your little house for your Yellowdig discussions. So to create your community, you're gonna go to the Yellowdig website and you'll have a login email and password there. And once you log in, click the create button, like you see at the top right here, and then enter your information for your community. And that's where all your Yellowdig discussions will take place. And then the next step we're going to talk about is how to set up your points. So the first step to setting up your points is going to the earning window, which is, you see the number one on your left by earning window, and you're going to enter your course start and end dates, and you can also edit the amount of points students receive for comments, posts, and reactions. And you can see in our little screenshot, Yellowdig does give you default points that they recommend for those using it. And then we're going to go through a couple features in Yellowdig, but before we do that, I'm going to turn it back over to Lynn so she can talk about some modules we set up in our D2L courses.
Okay, so in our online course shells, we created a clear instructions for students. As you can see here, these are the modules we created to prepare students for the new tool they will be using in the course. I'm not going to go into details, but it's what is Yellowdig, how to access the community, how to participate in Yellowdig, and most importantly, how will you be graded? Okay, Erin, if you can continue.
Awesome, thank you. So Yellowdig has a lot of really cool features in its interface, but today we're just gonna cover a few of the key features that our team has found using it. So first part that we're gonna go through is the community health dashboard. So the community health dashboard is located on your navigation pane. So if you look at the screenshot on the left, it's right under data. And highlights health in your community by keeping track of interactions that are happening between community members, all the students in your course. And community health has a summary tab, health check, tab, and topics by member. The summary tab focuses on total points, total comments, reactions, and conversation ratio. Conversation ratio is the most important because it shows how students are interacting back and forth on Yellowdig platform. And we learned that Yellowdig recommends aiming for a conversation rate of about 8.0. And on our left, this is an example of one of our community health dashboards. And then health check tab has the community health composite scores, which give instructors a picture of their community strengths and weaknesses. A three composite score is sharing, listening, and interacting, which shows how students are sharing with their peers, listening, and interacting with their peers on Yellowdig. And these scores can range from 0 to 100. We learned that Yellowdig recommends the strive for a score of 75 across all of the areas. And then we're going to go through the topics tab. So the topics tab gives instructors a bird's eye view of what the students are talking about. So it shows all the different topics in the course. And on our next slide, we'll talk about how to set up topics. So how to create topics. So to create topics, it's right under settings from our little screenshot. And then you're going to want to click create new topics. And then based on the topics for your course, you can enter whatever topic you like. And you can also make them required, which helps students focus their thoughts. And I'm going to turn it back to Ling to talk about our little Q&A period. If you have any questions.
Sure. Just a quick reminder that we'll have 15 to 20 minutes at the end of our presentation to take your questions. But before we move on to Marnie and Janeen, who will share with you faculty and students' perspectives on Yellowdig, we'll just take a quick pause and gather our thoughts. If you have any questions or comments, just please write them down on your own notes or submit them in chat. I'm already seeing some questions there, so we don't forget about these questions. And we'll make sure to come back and address your questions in the end. So we'll just stop talking now for a minute, give you time to write down your questions.
Okay, I'll go ahead and dive in and share a few thoughts regarding our pilot from the faculty perspective. And right, somebody just asked if this is used in, you know, asynchronous online, hybrid, and so on. The answer is, theoretically, you can use it in really any of those formats. We right now are piloting Yellowdig in our online asynchronous classes. So everything is online. So I'd like to begin by sharing some thoughts regarding how Yellowdig feels different and looks different from an LMS online discussion board. So, you know, Canvas, Blackboard, World Class, D2L, all of those are LMS discussion boards. And as an instructor, certainly one of the most common observations both that I've had and that I've heard from my colleagues is simply that these discussion boards are so prescriptive, right? Ideally, the discussion community is where our class can come together and exchange ideas and ask questions and learn and so on. I mean, if you're teaching in a face-to-face or any kind of synchronous modality, you know that there's that slight kind of unpredictability because students are different and they come to the classroom with different interests, and you try and take the material and relate it to their interests. I teach philosophy, but I think this is true in even, you know, science and math, right? So the LMS discussion board is highly prescriptive. We as instructors have typically written out our discussion prompts before the class even begins. And this is an example of what, you know, a typical LMS discussion might look like. You have, you know, your primary prompt, and then you have these steps that you're asking students to complete, and, you know, you've tied it already to an outcome and so on. And as a result, our discussions look the same, not only in all of our different classes, but often within the same class from week to week, you can predict what your discussion board is going to look like, right? Very little, you know, happens on a discussion board in an asynchronous online class that is unpredictable, that surprises you. And I think that teaching and real learning is difficult in that kind of environment. It's partly that unpredictability that students bring and that you meet them with as an instructor that creates a kind of exciting environment where learning can take place. So here's what a Yellowdig discussion board looks like. We want to go ahead and take a look at this. So Yellowdig discussions are open-ended. And here's what I mean by that. The students have read the material that you've assigned or looked at whatever lecture you posted and so on. And then in your kind of formal instructions, you really are leaving it fairly open. You're saying, part of your weekly activity is to contribute to the Yellowdig discussions. And then you might, in parentheses, include a few potential ideas, but you're not prescribing what students will post on. They are engaging with the material, and then they are being asked to follow their own interests or follow what they think is important. So here's an example from a pharmacy ethics class. And you can see even within these two postings, one student has read the material and they've been excited or interested in this topic about drugs that doctors prescribe and the relationship that doctors have to these drugs and the knowledge and so on. So they found a TED talk, a lecture, and they've posted that and they've made a few comments and connected up some of the material. And underneath that, a different student has followed this other sort of interest or thing that struck them in the material and has posted an article and made some comments. Now, Yellowdig is set up, or at least, and you can control partially how you'd like this to look, but students cannot simply grab, lectures and grab links and post them without also commenting on it and connecting some of the material. And so that's rather ingenious. And you can, again, it's set up that way as a default setting. They need to craft a post of at least some length, right? When they share their material. Now, partly what this requires is that as an instructor, you need to take a leap of faith somewhat that your students are going to be engaging with the material. But then once they, share whatever it is they're going to share, you can jump in and redirect, you can jump in and encourage. So here's, in terms of the paradigm of the LMS discussion versus the Yellowdig discussion, you need to make a sort of shift of attitude, right? So one thing that I try and do in my philosophy classes is that I am critically engaging with my students' arguments. I'm not giving them my argument necessarily and asking them to engage with it. I'm asking my students to formulate their own arguments, and then I dive in just like everybody else and I pose questions. I pose questions that I don't know the answer to. In philosophy, that's easy. But again, I know that science professors have also used Yellowdig and math instructors. So it's not only a kind of humanities, structured conversational or discussion format. I invite students to share resources and topics of interest. We just saw an example of that. I try and act as a collaborator with my students. So instead of being the sage on the stage delivering a monologue, I'm just a character actor with the rest of the character actors, and I'm trying to engage in a real dialogue. And partly, in addition to helping students engage with material, it really does enhance kind of the community classroom environment. And this sort of leads to, maybe just some deeper sort of questions regarding what an instructor brings to class in terms of intellectual virtues and so on. I will say one thing that it forced me to do as an instructor is really articulate clearly what it is that I would like to use my discussions for. What am I using that discussion community for? So if I'm using it to simply impart facts that I want my students to learn, do I really need to do that in a discussion? Granted, in philosophy, I want them to know the names of certain philosophers. I want them to know theories that are not always straightforward. I want them to sort of, do a little bit of memorization. When they say empiricism, they know what they're referring to. However, I feel that when I wish to impart that sort of knowledge, I can do it in a non-discussion format. And then they can bring it over to this discussion if they wish and ask questions and so on. So I've really clarified my own goals as an instructor in terms of what I wish to accomplish within my online discussion community. And this might be the perfect time to pass the baton over to my colleague, Janeen Galligan, who's gonna talk a little bit about what Yellowdig feels like from a student's perspective and what some of their reactions have been.
Thank you, Marnie. Yes, as we've been saying all along, we haven't adopted Yellowdig as a tool for our university at this time. We're still in a pilot. So as part of the pilot, I consistently ask my students, what do you think? How do you like it? What are some of the features you like? How does it compare to our current learning management system, LMS? So overall, if we go to the next slide, there's some general positive feedback pretty much across the board, although there's always the outlier. The primary positive feedback from students is that they do like that it feels more like social media than a classroom discussion page. And to add on to that, it's because they like the conversation of it. It doesn't feel as forced to them. It feels more natural. They enjoy posting reactions. I do have the arrows pointing to what some of the reactions look like, but it's those emojis or it's just the thumbs up. A lot of times a student will post something and we want to let them know we read it. I mean, student to student, they want to let the other student know they read it, but they don't have anything to add on. And this in Yellowdig gives them the opportunity to say, yeah, thumbs up or okay, or clap, just some kind of reaction that, yes, I agree with you. I saw what you did, but they don't have to write the great post as we may see in a traditional LMS. So as we go on to the next slide, a couple of the other items that they generally like, and again, there's always the outliers, but they generally like that gamification and point system. And to expand on this a little bit, I know that Erin and Ling went over how to set this up, but students are consistently awarded posts for when they create a post, when they respond to somebody else, when they provide a reaction, when they get something called an accolade from the instructor, which is, hey, you're really, this is fantastic work. And students at all times can see where they stand. So there, we have taken away the question of, is my post good enough? Is this enough information? They consistently know where they stand. And then what we do is we're looking for those students to get full credit each week or full amount of points each week. And then at the end of the class, we'll go ahead and, again, because this is a pilot, we have to go ahead and put that into their discussion posting grade. But as I understand it, if we were to adopt it, that would all happen seamlessly. So the students at all times would know where they stand with their discussion grades. Another feature is they like how the videos and links display in the posting. Marnie had some great examples here to show you that you could see right there in the post that what the video is or what the story is to the link. And they really enjoy that because it prevents them from the multiple clicking and multiple windows opening up. So that is some primary positive feedback that we have received from students. As we go to the next slide, I'm going to share with you specific comments. And I do apologize for the wall of text, but I didn't want to take anything out of context. Again, the question I ask them is, just give me feedback. What do you think about Yellowdig? Your opinion is really valuable to us. So some of the feedback I've gotten: one, I'm enjoying the Yellowdig platform. I do think it's more powerful than World Class. World Class is what we call our learning management system. In terms of student interactions and involvement, however, it can be confusing. It's a bit of a disordered mess, even with filtering options. This is something that as students start using it more, they they get a sense of how the posts are laid out, and students are telling me they are seeing all posts, but it's definitely a different organization, especially for the linear thinkers like myself. At first, I found Yellowdig to be confusing, but after time, I discovered Yellowdig to be super simple and fun. It feels more like social media than just a regular classroom discussion page. That's one of the points about how they like that feel. The point system and word count keeps me engaged toward my goal. As Marnie pointed out, they can't just post a link or share a TED Talk. They need to provide context of what it is that they're sharing and why. And it is by meeting the word counts that they earn points, depending on if they're commenting or creating a new post. And as we go on to the next slide, I also feel there should be more defined structure to our posts. I like the freedom of being able to post whatever and get credit, but there still needs to be some relevance. So this is a consistent feedback we hear from students, is that it helps when the instructors give them some guidelines, but not the specific, this is what I want you to give me, give it back to me. It's more general ideas. One of the things I neglected to mention is that I teach communication. So we might, and I have piloted Yellowdig in two classes, one public speaking and the other one intercultural communication. So right now in our intercultural communication class, we're comparing different cultural dimensions or cultural ideologies among different countries. And so I'm not telling them exactly what to do, but I'm suggesting, hey, why don't you go check out this website, compare a couple of countries, let us know what you found. Or here's another idea, or here's another idea. They're not bound to those discussion questions that I create. It's definitely less formal than the Regis World Class Board. It seems to work great in this class, but I wonder about some other courses that are more structured by the topic. Marnie, I think, addressed this. We do think that it can be adopted in other classes, but we can only speak to what we have used it for. So for communication classes, it's fantastic because we're constantly pulling in current events and real world experiences. And then the last comment I want to share, because this is the one that gets us really excited, this is the one that gets us up in the morning, is which other classes will be piloting Yellowdig? I may be interested in taking another 8-week course using this program. This to us means student engagement. It means that they were excited to use it. They were engaged. They're looking for the opportunities to sign up for another class that is using it. So overall, those are some of the comments that I've gotten from students. As with any tool, you're going to have your positives and your negatives. I can say from a faculty perspective, I've thoroughly, thoroughly enjoyed using it. And I haven't ever lost track of a student. I'm able to see what all students are posting and make sure, because one of the things that our school, we really pride ourselves on, is that student interaction and connection. And I haven't lost that at all in the Yellowdig board. In fact, I definitely see more student-to-student interactions coming out. So I think that is all I have to say. I will turn it back to April.
Thanks, Janeen. So I think what we'd like to do next is kind of summarize some of our main takeaways. And my apologies for not being able to move this screen right now. Hold on 1 second. Okay. So there's pros and cons, as we've mentioned throughout, and we've learned quite a bit about Yellowdig, and it's been a wonderful pilot for us. But if we were to summarize what we are seeing, and to let all of you in the audience know and help you maybe gauge some questions that you have for us, these are the main takeaways. It is another tool to manage for students and for faculty, obviously. But on the plus side, the integration is really easy. As we mentioned, it's not seamless for us yet because it's a pilot program, but everything we've used so far, other than looking at the grading of the discussions will work seamlessly. So that's been a plus on that side. Something that you might could look at as a negative would be that facilitators have to relinquish control. But really, that's not such a bad thing when you're looking at asynchronous online learning. It brings post-traditional students in particular, you know, into the conversation and gives them more control because they're getting to bring their own ideas and their own lived experience to the table and to those forum discussions. And as we all know, then whenever you're in an online course, you know, the more people that are talking and sharing their own experience, the more robust the conversation is going to be. So this leads to the positive side, which is these, you know, the students are leading the discussions here, and it gives them more of an ownership, and they're, you know, bringing their A game in different ways. On the negative side, you could say, well, students need to learn a new tool. But the plus is that the online classroom feels more dynamic. And in our experience, students aren't really having a super hard time with it. Again, you know, some filtering options and things that we can, you know, assist them with to make it easier, but they seem to be enjoying it thus far. Since we've gone through the takeaways now, it might be a good idea now to move to some Q&A and see what questions you have for us and answers that perhaps we can share in regard to what we've learned so far in the pilot.
Perhaps as people are formulating questions, there's one other thing I wanted to mention, which is a rather interesting feature for facilitators. Namely, since the way that your discussions are formatted, you know, it being different leads to much more conversation and circulation within the various weeks of your class. So as you know now with your online asynchronous discussions, typically it feels like, okay, week two is over, now we're going on to week three, and often the week two material never really comes up explicitly again. Well, using Yellowdig, it's very easy to bump up a thread that was posted regarding the week two material and connect it to an idea in week five, six, seven. And as a result, you get this really interesting circulation of content in your class, which is largely what we look for and we try to do. And it usually feels rather artificial because we're the ones doing it. But now it's very easy for students to do it. And it's really cool when you're teaching and you're in week eight or nine and suddenly you see a week two thread, you know, pop up and it comes to life again. The thread will come to life again because the content continues to be relevant through your course. Feels much more organic, like an organic discussion, like what you might do if you were talking to students face to face, or how somebody might respond.
Yeah, one thing that really impressed me is that so far, Marnie and Janeen can jump in, I don't think students have any technical issues with the tool. Like we give them a link to sign up to the community, they're able to log in, no problem at all. So yeah, typically it's always just one or two students have some technical difficulties, but no, I'm really, really impressed about that.
Yeah, and those technical difficulties happen, you know, almost regardless of the format that you're using. And I will say, I'm not a big social media person anymore. So if you're somebody that you just hear the word like social media and kind of tune out, I deleted my social media accounts long ago and I don't miss them one bit. But since this is the kind of, you know, it feels relevant, it feels interesting and engaging. So it's social media at its best, you know, when you're kind of stripping away some of the negative aspects of social media. So.
Agreed, Marnie. It's like everybody in a room talking about the social media, but talking about the same things in the same ways without the negativity, right? And I wanted to add to what you were saying earlier. I agree, Ling. I haven't had students have a problem with the technology piece of it. And I was holding my breath at the beginning of the class thinking, oh, nobody's going to be able to create this account. It's going to be horrible. And that's been really seamless. The only thing I would say that, you know, has been any kind of difficulty is students finding some of the posts at times, trying to filter through. But once we've worked through some of those issues and we're all kind of approaching it the same way, that's been fine as well. But there's certainly seeing them bring media and YouTube clips and or songs or pictures or whatever it's going to be to the forum when you open it up. It's really exciting now, I think, to go in and read people's posts as a facilitator in a way that I haven't felt in a while. So it's, I feel like everything, you know, is brighter, shinier, more interesting for everyone involved.
And speaking as a faculty member who's been teaching online for at least a decade, I would like to add on to what April was saying. I'm assuming we're all within within friends right now, but I think a lot of times instructors can get a little demotivated about the discussion board. I mean, I've heard it time and time again. Oh my gosh, I'll do anything except those discussions. And this really elevates the conversation and makes it more engaging. And you're focused not on the more tedious sides and focus more on being engaged with students. I do see that there was a question earlier, which is what other models for discussion posts are you using other than the post once, reply twice? I don't know, Marnie, do you want to take this?
Did you have something specific in mind? Are you talking about tools like potentially VoiceThread and so on?
Yeah, I think that question is actually as a discussion point, not just for speakers, us, but for the whole community. That's a traditional what we think, right? The discussion model. And I think Heidi has something in mind, just trying to start the conversation, like what other colleagues are doing in their discussion forum, what other models they are doing.
Yeah, that's a good point, because anybody who's been teaching asynchronous classes online, undoubtedly, you've hit that point where you're thinking, oh my God, what else can I do with my discussions? Can I format them differently? Can I bring in, you know, you don't want to start loading your class with all this external content and external tools. You want it to feel integrated, like all of these things. But yes, it's a challenge that everybody has faced, who's taught online has faced. So sure, if anybody, you know, even has a specific thing that you've tried in a more traditional LMS system that you think has worked. I mean, it's the continual challenge. It's ever new, ever fresh in instructors' minds, it feels like. I will say what Yellowdig does not feel like. It doesn't feel like you're just having to, it's not like you have another tool that you're needing to go outside of your learning management system to access. I think, one of the big pluses is that I know that the Yellowdig people are working really hard to make Yellowdig feel integrated. And I've seen different versions of it in platforms other than our world class, like Canvas and Blackboard. And it really does both look and feel integrated within the class if a college decides to adopt it, which, as we've said, we haven't formally adopted yet. This is still very much in the piloting stage.
I know in the chat there's an accessibility question. I'm actually not sure if a video is automatically captioned. I know for audio, you can't just record an audio in the system. You have to upload an audio clip that you already have.
Oh, is that right? So I might have misspoke earlier because somebody asked that. That's right. I think they're working on getting that audio fully integrated so that you can record it right there in the system. Yeah. Video you can.
Yeah, video you can record right there. Erin, have you checked that out?
Yeah, I'm sending some resources from Yellowdig about accessibility into our chat.
And it sounds like these questions that are coming up, I believe that someone from Yellowdig is on our call. So Jim, if you wanted to type in some answers in the chat, I think the last two questions are really addressed to you. And April, I don't know if you want to go to that next slide, just so that everybody could see that here's the contact for Yellowdig. If you are interested and want to learn more about the product, for us, we just wanted to share with you our perspectives, because we are doing this pilot and we are people that have been working in the asynchronous world for a long time. And when we find a tool that we're excited about, we want to share it with others.
I know for 4PI issues, we're not able to share the live Yellowdig court sites with you, but we do have a sandbox sites that we play just among ourselves. If anyone's interested, I think we can do a screen share with you here. Just if you can give me some feedback in chat, are you interested to see what it looks like in real life? Mike's interested. Yeah, so Erin, are you prepared to share? Or do you want me to?
Yeah, I can share.
Okay, so I think April, you will have to stop sharing so Erin can share. Yeah, our class size is typically pretty small. So for the pilots, I would say it's between 6 and 20. That's the size. Mm-hmm. That actually brings up a good question. I wonder if any of you want to address that, the class size. We had a pretty good discussion on that among ourselves. Mm-hmm. We noticed that
Top share at the top. Got it.
I know. No, I'm sorry. My keyboard is sticking, so I'm having a really hard time with all this. So I just wanted to jump out of here and get back this way to get rid of the tabs now that it's late in the day. And let me see if I can get out of sharing. My apologies.
Yeah, regarding class size, all of our classes are quite small. Relatively speaking, but I know for certain, because I did some research as I was wanting to learn more about Yellowdig and how I can approach it. I know that some kind of traditional lecture hall style 200 students type classes are using Yellowdig, I think, to pretty great success, and largely because it is so student generated, right? So the onus isn't always on the instructor to keep everything on track and to continually devise ever newer and more interesting prompts and so on. So I think that it can easily accommodate all class sizes.
I almost think the bigger class sizes easier, better, because a smaller class size, only if you have only 6 students, the discussion is quite limited. To earn all the points, you almost have to respond to everybody. Sometimes it can be a little onus.
Yeah, that's exactly right. And it, you know, as we all know, teaching us, facilitating a small discussion can be challenging regardless of format. And so I do think that, there is it's nice to have more people in Yellowdig. However, I would feel exactly the same way if I were teaching a face-to-face class. Teaching, generating and stimulating conversations with 6 people can be challenging. I was gonna say, even as grad students, maybe especially grad students, talk about prescriptive.
Link, you mind sharing your screen? And I can zoom through a little bit.
What's that, Erin?
You mind sharing your screen?
Oh, sure. Mm-hmm. Oh, yeah, go ahead. Mm-hmm.
And one other point, as you're working on sharing your screen, that I might add is that I know too, because as facilitators, it feels like we're constantly being bombarded with, like the next piece of technology that's going to be like a magic wand that transforms our class and so on. When I hear the word gamification, I tend to take a deep breath. I'm not, even as somewhat of a gamer, I'm not a huge gamer, but I don't necessarily like kind of the slickness of the concept. But I will say the truth is, if you're administering any kind of grade for your discussion, you already are generating points that you are going to give to the student. I mean, that is a gamification of, in its own right. So the real difference is with Yellowdig is that students see how it is that they're building up their participation grade or whatever you call your discussion style grade. They can see it. They see how it works. There's never any doubt about where they stand. They can look for themselves and see exactly where they're, where and how and why to generate points. Right. So gamification, I think, can sometimes be a little misleading because it comes with all these associations that might not be valid in all cases or even many cases.
Mm-hmm. Are you able to share, Erin?
It's not letting
me. Not letting you share? Let me try it. Let's see. Okay. Okay. Can you see this?
Yes.
Okay. Mm-hmm. So this is our sandbox. This is what it looks like. You can pin your post for the important messages.
Mm-hmm. And you can also like make comments. And that's where if you want to click comment or reply, that you can add record videos. So you can see there's record video and audio.
So it's calculating the word count. You can do add images, videos, emoji, draw, formula, record mm-hmm. video right here. Okay. And what I just posted. Okay. Mm-hmm. And these are the topics we're talking about. So as you post a message, you can select which topic. Is it a current event? Is it a question? So you can tag it. So it's easier for other people to search. So it's not required, but you, as an instructor, you can decide if you want to make that feature required or not.
Yeah, and I will say, speaking of the topics in general, as a first-time user of Yellowdig, it is really helpful to require that your students choose from a topic. And typically you'll go through your weeks, and what I've done, you know, you choose the primary topic for each week, right? And then you have, you know, a question topic and so on. But what it requires students to do as well is after they've kind of formulated their response, they really, the onus is on them to sort of look and see, okay, now where does my post fall? What's the topic of my post? And then it does make also just sorting and formatting easier and getting, you know, you can get to whatever you call week one, you know, Plato's cave. So you don't have to require topics, but you can. And I think it's helpful, particularly for newer facilitators.
Yeah, and as you participate, you can see the points you're earning right here. You can check out the points and you can filter the message either by date. There's so many options. Mm-hmm. Yeah, so however you want to sort message.
Yeah, I think if you go under settings, that's where you set up your points.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Mm-hmm.
So I think that we are going to get kicked off in a minute and 10 seconds. So should we take this opportunity just to say thank you all for your time and reach out to us if you have any questions too. We're always happy to help.
Yeah, thank you everyone for coming.
Thank you.
Thanks.
Great presentation, Regis.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thanks, Doug.
Stop share.
Are you all okay if I stop the recording now?
Yes, please.
Yes.
All right.
Thank you.
Thank you.